Hello everyone, welcome back to Max Talk Talk session. So today we have Dr. Deepa Dewan, Associate Director and Head of Unit, Max Hospital, Gurgaon. Today we'll be discussing the topic Pregnancy Precautions and Childbirth Complications. Hello Doctor.
Hello.
So Doctor, while pregnancy is a joyful experience, there are a number of worrisome queries that arise in the minds of to-be parents. We will try our best to clear as many doubts as possible. So, Doctor, my first question to you is, what are the warning signs of miscarriage during pregnancy?
So, a patient who would come with some amount of lower abdomen pain, bleeding. So, these are some signs which tell us this could be a miscarriage. So, these are the signs which a patient might present with. So, somebody has missed her period and she's done a pregnancy test at home and then realized that she started bleeding all of a sudden. So this could be one of the signs where we would suspect that could it be a miscarriage. But we also have to look at other things. So probably do a blood test, do a beta HCG, find out if the pregnancy is positive, and then do an ultrasound to find out what is the location of the pregnancy, how the baby is doing. So these are the things that need to be checked.
So Doctor, can you also tell me about the first signs of a miscarriage?
Yeah, so first signs of miscarriage can be bleeding or severe lower abdomen pain. So pain in the lower tummy is something that can present as a sign of miscarriage.
Thank you so much, Doctor. Coming on to the next question, when should one be extra careful during their trimester?
So there is nothing like being extra careful in any trimester. So in the first trimester, one has to have a diagnosis that the pregnancy is inside the uterus. It should not be at a different site other than the uterus. The baby's heartbeat should have been checked. The second trimester, one has to find out that the baby is growing normally. We also want to find out that the baby's organs are well formed. In the third trimester, there are other complications which can come in. Like somebody can have a high blood pressure, somebody can have a high sugar level, the baby's growth can be restricted. So again, certain things have to be noted. So there's nothing like being careful in any trimester. Throughout the pregnancy, one has to watch out for certain signs and get their regular checkups done. That is what is important.
So Doctor, is there any critical week that should be kept into consideration during pregnancy?
So there is no critical week as such. Like I said, that every stage of pregnancy, there are certain things which are important. There are certain things which are important in the first trimester. So in the first trimester, a patient has to look out for any pain in the lower tummy, any bleeding, any signs which would direct us to a complication. In the second trimester, the patient has to look at other things, like has she got her ultrasounds done in time? Has the level 2 ultrasound been done? Have they checked that the baby's organs are well formed? So those are the things that have to be checked in the second trimester. In the third trimester, the patient has to check that she has not had any problems with her sugar. So has her glucose tolerance test been done? Has the blood pressure been all right? Is she gaining the right kind of weight? It's like these complications normally come up in the third trimester, like things like a high blood pressure or maybe presence of glucose being high in the blood. So of course these things have to be monitored, but there's nothing like a critical trimester or a critical month in pregnancy.
Thank you, Doctor. So now, Doctor, let's talk a little bit about silent miscarriage. So what is a silent miscarriage?
So what is called a silent miscarriage, what you're calling a silent miscarriage, is also what is called a missed abortion.
Okay.
So that means the baby stopped growing in utero and the patient doesn't know about it. So this can happen sometimes when we check on ultrasound. Let's say a patient has gone for her level 1 ultrasound at 12 weeks. And on ultrasound, the doctor finds out that the baby is not growing. So that is what a missed miscarriage could be. So there might or might not be any signs of this. So if the patient had any bleeding or pain, then she of course would have gotten ultrasound done earlier. But sometimes it happens that you haven't had any symptoms and the baby's just stopped growing.
And Doctor, how can we avoid this?
So most of the miscarriages which would happen in the first trimester, almost to the tune of 70%, happen because the baby is not normal. So there is an abnormality and the baby stopped growing. There could be another 15% which would happen because there's some problem in the mother, like there could be an infection, there could be a high thyroid level, there could be a high sugar level, there could be other problems like phospholipid syndrome, there could be a thrombophilia. So these could be reasons for a miscarriage to happen. And there's another 10 to 15% which are unknown reasons. So it's not that one can avoid a miscarriage, but yes, before one gets pregnant, one should get a few tests done to find out that her body is fit for the pregnancy. Like a rubella check should be done. So one should check that she is immune to rubella. There should be a check on the sugars of the mother. So the sugars of the mother should be normal before she conceives. Her thyroid should be checked. So these things, if they, the basic things have been checked, then the chances of a miscarriage would be less. At least the miscarriage that would happen because of medical problems in the mother would be less.
Thank you, doctor. So, doctor, there are certain medical terminologies that people want to know related to pregnancy. Let's start with, what is ectopic pregnancy?
Okay. Ectopic, by the name, by the word itself, means that it is something other than normal. So the location of the pregnancy is not in the normal site, but at an abnormal site. That is why it is called an ectopic pregnancy. Now, that abnormal site can be inside the tube. It could be in the ovary. It could also be in the abdomen. So an ectopic pregnancy is a pregnancy which is not inside the uterus, but outside the uterus. Most of the ectopic pregnancies are tubal pregnancies. That means they're forming inside the tube of the patient, the fallopian tube. And the danger part about this is that they can sometimes get unnoticed if an ultrasound has not been done in time, and the patient can present with bleed or dizziness or severe pain in the abdomen. So it's important. So sometimes patients do ask us, why are you getting an ultrasound done so early at 7 weeks or 8 weeks? The main purpose of this ultrasound is, of course, to check that the pregnancy is in the right place, so we do not miss out on an ectopic, and also to see that the baby's heartbeat has developed.
So doctor, can ectopic pregnancy cause fertility issues later in life?
Yes, to some extent, I would say yes to it. So if the patient has had an ectopic pregnancy, and the ectopic has ruptured, then she might have spoiled her tube. So then her chances of conception might go down with that. Though everybody has two tubes inside, so even if one fallopian tube gets damaged, the other one is still there for the pregnancy to happen. But the reasons for an ectopic pregnancy can be a tube which is damaged. It could also be a tube which could be infected. So one has to keep these things in mind. So the only precaution that one can take if one has had an ectopic in the past is to get an ultrasound done in time when one gets pregnant. So if you have a pregnancy test which is positive, and so you should get a beta HCG done quickly. Talk to your doctor if your doctor wants a beta HCG to be repeated to see serial levels, get that done, and get an ultrasound done at the earliest to locate the pregnancy.
Doctor, a different question on the same terminology. What is placental abruption?
Yeah, so placental abruption means that the placenta for some patients can separate from the uterus. That means the placenta, between the placenta and the uterus, there's a blood collection and the placenta has separated from the uterus. These conditions can happen as an emergency situation for some people. And the problem with this is that the baby and the mother both can be at a risk because of something like this happening. So if somebody has a severe pain in the abdomen during a pregnancy, it's better to take medical help as early as possible.
Thank you, doctor. So my next question to you will be, should one rush to the ER in case of vaginal bleeding?
Yeah, so if you have vaginal bleeding during pregnancy, then definitely that's a symptom or the sign which must be reported to your doctor. So talk to your doctor. If you're unable to get in touch with your doctor, of course go to the ER and get it checked. So the reasons for a vaginal bleeding which could have happened in an early pregnancy can be A, it could be an implantation bleeding, which is normally nothing to be worried about. But talking to your doctor, discussing, probably getting an ultrasound will help us to diagnose what is happening. Secondly, it could also be a threatened miscarriage. That means the baby is trying to abort and that's why the bleeding has happened. It could be a missed abortion. So that means the baby stopped growing and that's why the bleeding is happening. It could also be an ectopic pregnancy, because one of the signs of ectopic pregnancy is bleeding, that is vaginal bleeding. plus abdominal pain and dizziness. So if you haven't had your ultrasound so far in pregnancy and you haven't got it checked where your pregnancy is located, then it might definitely want, we would want to check that it shouldn't be an ectopic pregnancy. Then there could be other reasons why a bleeding could happen in pregnancy. So that if it happens later in pregnancy. So if it happens later in pregnancy, again, it could be preterm labor. It could be an abruption. So anyways, it is always better to consult your doctor. Check with her. If you're able to reach out to your doctor, well and good. If you're not, go to the ER and get medical help.
My question to you is burning sensation during urination common?
Okay, burning sensation. So during urination, one should not have a burning sensation. Ideally, if a urination is happening in pregnancy, we would not expect burning sensation. So in such a scenario, it's better to get a urine routine culture done. Get yourself checked by your doctor as to why the burning is happening. Is there a local cause for burning? Is the local area inflamed? Is there a vaginal infection? Or is there anything in the urine like a urine infection which could be leading to it?
Okay, doctor, thank you. My next question to you is, what is shoulder dystocia?
Okay, shoulder dystocia is a medical term which we use when the baby's shoulder gets stuck during delivery. So this is one of the obstetric complications which can happen in the labor room for some people, especially for bigger babies. So sometimes it can happen, though these are very rare things, that the baby's head comes out and the shoulders get stuck. So this would normally happen for very heavy babies. So one doesn't have to get scared about a shoulder dystocia, reading about it, because it not happen to everybody. It's more expected to happen when we have heavier babies, wherein the head comes out and the shoulders get stuck. That is what shoulder dystocia is.
Thank you, doctor. The next question to you is, what are the early signs of labor?
Okay. So labor can be identified by the signs that I would enumerate now. So one, it could be show. Show could mean that there is a white mixed with red discharge which comes out. There could be an abdominal pain, and this abdominal pain happens in a regular manner. So when labor comes, it would be a tummy pain accompanied with a pain maybe in the back, and it comes in intervals. So very important thing about onset of labor is that when you get labor pains, it would be contractions or a pain which is happening in the tummy, and it's coming in regular intervals. So it will come say every 10 minutes initially, and then probably start increasing to every 5 minutes and then every 3 minutes till you get into active labor. So those could be the two signs. There could be a leakage of fluid, of the amniotic fluid. The leakage could be happening before the onset of labor, or it could be happening after the onset of labor, but that could also be a sign. So three signs that one has to look out for onset of labor is, one is to look out for show, that is a blood-tinged discharge. Two is the presence of leaking, which might or might not be there. Three is painful abdominal contractions coming at regular intervals and increasing in intensity and frequency. So these could be the signs of onset of labor.
Thank you, doctor. Can you also tell me about some emergency kit essentials that should be kept into consideration?
So there is nothing like an emergency kit essentials for pregnancy per se. So what you need at home is basically, you should have the contact numbers of your doctor, of the ER, of the ambulance numbers. You should have some sterile pads with you. So those are the things which you can have at home. But then, if there is any sign of a problem coming up, like pain, dizziness, which you're not understanding what it is, maybe a swelling in the leg, so it's better to consult the doctor.
So doctor, now let's talk about labor emergency. What is the obstetric emergencies during labor?
So obstetric emergencies that can happen is, one, we can start with, let's say, before the baby is delivered. So when the patient is in labor, there could be that the baby's heartbeat is not good. So that could be an obstetric emergency that could happen. The patient can have heavy bleeding. That could be an emergency that could happen. Now, emergencies could happen even during labor. So during labor or during the phase of delivery, it could be like you asked about shoulder dystocia. This can be an emergency. There can be emergencies which can happen post-delivery also. So post-delivery, it can be like something like postpartum hemorrhage. in which the bleeding becomes more than expected. So these can be some of the emergencies that can happen during a labor.
Doctor, what should one do in such situations?
So, see, if one is in labor and there is a labor emergency, so other than just bleeding which can happen at home and you might need to rush to the ER, or a labor pain which might start at home and you have to rush to the ER, rest of the emergency that I'm talking about are emergencies which would happen in the labor room when you're in labor or about to deliver or have delivered. So those are of course handled by the team in the hospital.
Thank you, doctor. We would like to know a little bit about intense dizziness. Should one rush to the ER if they experience intense headaches and dizziness?
Yes, definitely. So in pregnancy, if you have an intense dizziness or you have headache, definitely you must go to the hospital and get a checkup done. So for example, something like in an early pregnancy, if you have dizziness or if you have a severe headache, it could mean that one reason, like we talked about ectopic pregnancy. So one reason for a dizziness could be happening if you haven't still had your ultrasound and you haven't still diagnosed what is the location of the pregnancy. Then something like this could be because of an ectopic pregnancy, a dizziness which is happening in the first trimester. In the second and third trimester, if your blood pressure is high, again you can have some dizziness. So there are certain reasons for which a dizziness can happen. And you might need your doctor to check you up. And in case your doctor feels that you need to get checked by another specialist, like a physician or a neurologist, then that might also be required. So if there is dizziness, definitely you must talk to your doctor. It could even be something as simple as just being low on glucose. So if you haven't had food, you can feel a little dizzy also. If your BP is too low or BP is too high, you can still feel uneasy. So the important thing here is that if you do notice a symptom like this, please talk to your doctor and report to the hospital and get yourself checked.
Thank you, doctor. So my next question to you is, if one doesn't feel movement inside the womb, should they visit the ER?
Yeah, so if there is no movement inside the womb, definitely you must talk to your doctor, go to the hospital, get it checked. Sometimes it can happen that the baby is positioned in such a manner that you're not feeling the movement. So a check in the hospital will reassure you. But sometimes it can also be a sign of a danger. So in case you're, let's say, 36, 37 weeks pregnant and you haven't had movements for the whole day, definitely we would want to get a check done for you, like a non-stress test can be done. A check from a Doppler, just to check that the heartbeat is okay. Then a non-stress test to check that the baby is moving well. Maybe an ultrasound might also be required in such cases. So if you do not feel movements, you must report to the doctor immediately. Yes, there are, we normally tell our patients to do a daily fetal movement count in the third trimester. So every day one must check that the baby is moving. So in a day, if you're checking 10 movements is what is adequate movement. So there's a Cardiff's count to 10, which you can do. And once you're monitoring the movements and you feel at any point of time that the baby appears sluggish, it's better to get a check done, especially if you have a high-risk pregnancy like maternal diabetes or maybe a high blood pressure. Then these are reasons wherein, or maybe a baby which is too small can also, you have to be really careful about the movements of the baby and you must monitor them at home. And if you feel that the movements are absent or reduced, report to the doctor, understand from the doctor how you have to monitor the movements properly.
Thank you, doctor. Could you also tell a little bit about what is prolapsed umbilical cord?
Prolapsed umbilical cord. Okay. So this would be a question somebody would ask who's doing a lot of Google reading, I think. So prolapsed umbilical cord is that the cord of the baby. The cord is something that connects the baby to the mother. So that cord comes down before the baby's head. Is what a prolapsed cord is. So somebody who's in labor or the mouth of the uterus has opened, and so we would expect that once the mouth of the uterus opens, the head of the baby comes down. That's how the natural labor happens. But in rare situations, when the head is not fixed there, the cord can come in before the head. So that's called a prolapsed cord, and that's a big obstetric emergency.
Thank you so much, doctor, and thank you, audience, for joining. If you want to know more or you'd like to connect to the doctor, you can call on the mentioned number or you can also click on the link provided. We'll see you in the next Doc Talk sessions. Thank you, everyone.